In reference to our previous discussion of pediatric hematology and oncology, this is the last session that is related to pediatric oncology, where our main focus was on blood malignancy, but we will touch upon different pediatric oncology, especially in reference to outcome or prognosis. Let's start with the scenario of a 5-year-old boy who presented in our outpatient clinic with the problems of fever, pallor, and bone pains. He also had episodes of bleeding from gums for last 2 weeks. And at the time of admission, his examination revealed that he was pale, having bruises on the face as well as on the lower limbs. And in reference to abdominal examination, he has significant enlargement of spleen and cervical lymphadenopathy. So, in this background of history and examination, my queries to you is, what is your differential diagnosis? How will you plan to investigate this boy, and finally, how will you manage this patient? So, before moving on to other questions, let's help me that the differential diagnosis of a boy who presents with fever, pallor, bruises, lymphadenopathy, and significant splenomegaly. Our differential diagnosis rests upon first and foremost blood malignancy, that is acute leukemia, or what we call as acute lymphoblastic leukemia, I must say, then lymphoma, both Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin lymphoma, and out of infection, the most common malignancy which present with lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly, and fever in the 5-year-old boy is infectious mononucleosis. These are the common scenario of manifestations when a baby of different ages come to our outpatient clinic with different type of soft tissues or hematological or glandular malignancies. This is the presenting features of different type of malignancies in our setup in oncology department of a developing country. So in next 25-30 minutes, I will share with you something related to clinical morphology, what we call as pathophysiology, their clinical behavior, how to plan investigation, and finally, how to determine how to plan management of a patient of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. Objectives of my presentation, the major objective is to share with you knowledge related to different clinical aspects of acute lymphoblastic leukemia, but a few slides I will share about the global situation related to pediatric oncology. Then what are the problems which a pediatrician working in a developing country like Pakistan, the problems, the odds, the difficulties he come across, what are the practical solution to overcome these problems. But before concluding, my request to all of you is that at the end of your presentation, I will request you to submit to share your wisdom how to overcome these practical problems which we come across while treating these patients in a developing country, that is our beloved, very beloved Pakistan. So this slide just to share you that even in developed world, in Europe, America, and Scandinavia, it took few decades to improve their 5-year survival of different type of malignancies, from 55% to something around 80%. This recommendations or suggestions will be more obvious if you have a quick look on this bar slide, which depicts that from 1992 to 2008, almost about two decades, different type of malignancies, they have their group prognosis in reference to 5-year survival, especially if you look on Wilms tumor, if you look on acute lymphoblastic leukemia or lymphoma, especially non-Hodgkin lymphoma, there is more than 80 or something 90% survival in patient with these different type of childhood malignancies in developed world, in what we call as in advanced country with good standard of health care. And what is the reason how over few 2 to 3 decades there is significant improvement in the outcome of these malignancies in developed world? These are a few points which help you to understand that scientists, the clinician, the pathologists, the oncologists of that area, they worked hard on these factors, especially in reference to have a good outlook in the in understanding the biology, the outcome of the biology or pathophysiology of these diseases, different type of malignancies, and classifying different type of subgroup of these malignancies, so that every baby needs its own treatment, that we stratify treatment depending upon the stage, depending upon the severity of illness in that patient, and then we define or design the treatment for every patient. In addition to chemotherapy, they worked hard on different type of supportive therapy, especially in reference to components of blood transfusions like platelet concentrate, like WBC's transfusion, red blood cell transfusion. Similarly, good understanding of infectious complication, appropriate use of appropriate antibiotics, and similarly identifying the complications at an earlier stage in these children. And last but not the least, the outcome is not only related to effort of pediatrician or oncologist, it is a joint effort of surgeons, radiologists, pathologists, and above all, social services for the children as well as for their families. So coordinated efforts of all these different subspecialists ultimately leads to that good improvement in the outcome of childhood malignancies. So let's start with you, share with you some good knowledge about childhood malignancies. First thing is early detection of childhood malignancies. So in these patients, we think of malignancies in a child who present with persistent fever, increasing pallor, increasing degree of anemia, with bone pains, visceromegaly like lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly. So these are bruises. These are the so important manifestation that whenever a baby present with one or combination of these manifestations, we must think of malignancy, especially acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So such degree of lymphadenopathy, especially cervical lymphadenopathy, in the background of persistent fever, bruises, or hepatosplenomegaly make us to think that a patient is suffering from hematological malignancies like leukemia or lymphoma. So with this manifestation of pallor, bruises, lymphadenopathy and hepatosplenomegaly, we think of these different type of differential diagnoses, especially leukemia, then immune thrombocytopenic purpura, pallor, especially who present with pale and pallor and bruises. So we think of aplastic anemia. The one who present with bone pains or joint pains, we must think of autoimmune problems like JRA. So this is a list of good differential diagnoses which strike our mind whenever a baby who present with pallor, in addition to, though I must say, the first possibility is acute lymphoblastic leukemia, but these are the relevant differential diagnoses depending upon what is the combination of clinical manifestation with which baby present to us. As I mentioned in the first and second slide, that in addition to leukemia, out of hematological malignancy, lymphoma is another important differential diagnosis. You must understand that lymphoma practically is of lymphoid origin, originated from the lymph node, from the lymph node tissue in the lymph nodes, while leukemia, any type of leukemia, it has origin from myeloid tissue, which reside in the bone marrow. But ultimately, the diagnosis rests upon the different type of immunomarkers which we apply with the help of flow cytometry, and we will discuss in detail subsequently when we discuss the battery of investigation which we ask in these patients. So whenever who present baby present with these clinical manifestations, our investigation starts with simple investigation like CBC, what we called as total and differential leukocyte counts, on top of hemoglobin and platelets counts. The nature of CBC help to proceed with the bone marrow examination, where we look for abnormal or what we call a blast cell in the bone marrow aspirate. And whenever there is a blast cell in the bone marrow, we apply a different type of very special strain in the form of PAS or positive Acerski fraction or Sudan B black stain, which help to differentiate that patient is suffering from acute lymphoblastic leukemia or acute myeloid leukemia. So these different special strains help to differentiate these different type of leukemia. In addition to lymphoid and myeloid leukemia, with the help of special strains, depending upon the size of the red blood cells, depending upon the cytoplasm and nucleus ratio, we define or subdivide these leukemia into L1 morphology, L2 and L3 morphology, which is very much important in reference to determining the outcome of prognosis of patient with acute lymphoblastic leukemia. We call it as BFM classification, or L1, L2, L3 morphology. So this is the typical appearance of blast cell. You can appreciate that this is a type of L1 morphology in which whole of the cell space is covered with large size nucleus and very thin rim of cytoplasm outside these nucleoli. So this is a typical picture of L1 morphology, all are of similar size with very large size nucleus and a thin rim of cytoplasm. Compared to that, this is an L3 morphology in which there is relatively large size of cytoplasm, nucleus are of relatively small size, and they are of different size. At the same time, large, medium, or large size. So different type of blast cells with the relatively large size cytoplasm is indicative of L3 morphology. This is what we called as flow cytometry, which helped to determine with the help of immunophenotyping that cell or blast cell is belonging to which category. It is T cell or B cell leukemia, and out of B cell, it also help to determine that it is pre-B cell leukemia or early pre-cell leukemia or transitional cell B cell leukemia. The most common and having good prognosis is the one which is early pre-B cell leukemia, which is more than 50% of the subgroup of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And T cell leukemia, which is having poor prognosis, is also determined with the help of immunophenotyping. Just to give you a sigh of relax, up till now what we have discussed is that acute leukemia or lymphoblastic leukemia is the most common type of malignancy, and we discussed that we can classify leukemia depending upon the stains of Sudan B or PAS into ALL or AML, and ALL is further subdivided depending upon the BFM classification into L1, L2 and L3 morphology, and with the help of flow cytometry we differentiate into T cell or B cell, and B cell are further divided into early pre-B cell, pre-B cell or transitional cell lymphoblastic leukemia. We apply battery of investigation starting with the peripheral blood picture, then move on to bone marrow, application of special strains, and finally with the help of flow cytometry we subclassify acute lymphoblastic leukemia. Before moving on to management, I will share a few minutes that how we classify ALL into subtype into risk stratification, because when we were discussing that good outcome of leukemia depends upon the individualized therapy for every patient, and that individualized therapy is dependent upon the risk stratification, that we classify our patient into standard risk or high risk patient depending upon these different type of considering these different type of factors. So if a baby is having TLC count less than 50,000, it has good prognosis. If his or her age is between 2 to 10 years of age, especially a female baby, girls has better prognosis than male babies. So a girl patient, a female patient between 2 to 10 years of age, and if on immunophenotyping is having pre-B cell of, early pre-B cell of leukemia, they have good prognosis. While a patient who is having translocation at chromosome 9 and 21, what we call as Philadelphia chromosome, they have poor prognosis. And if he is having involvement of CNS or testis, that is extramedullary sites, even mediastinal involvement, they have poor prognosis. So response to therapy depends upon these different type of prognostic factors. Treatment of acute lymphoblastic leukemia, we subdivide into these different four phases. First is induction phase, in which our objective is to clear the bone marrow, or at least the bone marrow which normally has more than 80-90% blast cell at the start of therapy, that is at the end of induction phase, the blast cell should be less than 5%. Then we have a CNS prophylaxis to clear by intrathecal therapy or by cranial irradiation along with systemic chemotherapy. We make the subarachnoid space or spine or brain of or brain of the child to clearly get rid of every cell of malignancy. So craniospinal clearance of the patient with the help of CNS prophylaxis, and then by some intensified therapy we again consolidate our induction and CNS prophylaxis with the use of another phase of therapy which we called as consolidation therapy, and finally the maintenance phase which spans over a period of 2 to 2.5 years that at the end of their 2 to 2.5 year of maintenance therapy, we depict, we decide that the patient is now almost relieved of his problem of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So total duration of therapy of acute lymphoblastic leukemia, depending upon the high risk or standard risk, 2 to 3 years. Induction phase lasts for 4 weeks. Just to name the medicine, vincristine, daunomycin, L-asparaginase, and prednisolone, which is used in induction phase. But you have to remember that the total duration of induction phase is 4 weeks. CNS prophylaxis phase, as I mentioned, we use crinoline irradiation, intrathecal methotrexate, and some systemic chemotherapy for 2 weeks. Consolidation, in which we use vincristine, cytosine arabinoside, daunomycin for 6 weeks, and finally maintenance therapy, in which our main focus is to have mild to moderate chemotherapy in the form of vincristine, prednisolone, methotrexate, and cytosine arabinoside for 2 to 2.5 years, which at the end of that maintenance therapy, one can announce that our patient has been cleared of his malignancy of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. The management of lymphoblastic leukemia is comprises of, in addition to this chemotherapy, we come across number of complications. And just to share with you that because of hypersensitivity to chemotherapy, different type of blood factors or antibiotics, regularly decline of hemoglobin, needs for blood transfusions in the form of packed red blood cells, very high total leukocyte counts, which sometimes come into lack, leads to hyperviscosity. Chemotherapy leads to tumor lysis, breakdown of large number of blood cells, which ultimately leads to a change into hyperkalemia, hyperphosphatemia, hyperuricemia. So electrolyte upsets, another common problem, which makes the treatment a little difficult. And last but not the least, neutropenia, which make these patients susceptible to life-threatening complications in the form of sepsis, in the form of pneumonia, in the form of cellulitis, phlebitis. So that makes this treatment a little difficult. So these are the acute complications which we come across in these patients. But there are a number of other long-term complications, like some neurological problems because of cranial irradiation, intrathecal chemotherapy. Similarly, these patients, because of exposure to different type of chemotherapy, they are liable to develop second malignancy. Chemotherapy make these patients sterile. They have, in their adolescent age, in their adult age, when they survive, they come across with the problem of sterility, different type of endocrine abnormalities, psychosocial problems in the children as well as in their parents. So these are the management of acute lymphoblastic leukemia is full of these different type of acute and long-term complications. But before moving forward, let me assure you that this is one type of malignancy which has excellent prognosis, especially in reference to 5-year survival, and it has a if not excellent, but I must say good prognosis. In developed world, in advanced countries where there is lot of support in reference to different availability of chemotherapy drugs, use of good pathological and pathology and radiology services with the social support, they have more than 80% of their baby, they survive five, they have 5-year survival and long-term outcome in the developed world. But what about developing countries with constraints in reference to availability of drugs, in reference to availability of good oncological services and support services in our country. The prognosis is not excellent, but still we are able to save 50% of our patients who they are enjoying life in different phases over the last 2 decades with our efforts of our doctors, our nurses, our health department. We have good example to share with you that we are able to save 50% of our children suffering from acute lymphoblastic leukemia. Our outcome is not like developed world. There are number of reasons. Although the availability of resources and especially financial resources are the one reason, our common man is not very literate to come in time to the health facility for treatment. They don't generally follow the guidelines, not follow the instructions of their medical facility. Many a time they discontinue their therapy and they leave against medical advice for no reason. Similarly, the health facility are very limited and the patient have to cover long journeys of 100 kilometers and 100 kilometers to get rid of disease and to get their chemotherapy, to get treatment for their day-to-day problems. So that is the reason that our outcome of these patients is not like in developed world, like 80 to 90%, but still we are able to save many of our patients. To share with you, Salim from Tehsil Shakargarh and Muhammad Aslam of Mandi Baudin and Tahurul Islam, son of our school teacher. Now, currently, he is enjoying his exam of A-level at a grammar school. So these are, there are so many our brave patients and their parents. They have defeated their disease and now in their adolescent and they're in their student's life and enjoying their life as well as their educational achievement. So that was made possible because the joint effort of me, my team, my colleagues who are working in different tertiary care hospitals in reference to pediatric oncology, and they are good support to children suffering from childhood malignancy, especially leukemia, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and so many other like Wilms tumor, neuroblastoma, retinoblastoma. So these type of childhood malignancies, we are able to help our community, our society, and our very loving children. You can appreciate that this group has increasing and increasing. These are different patients at different stages of their life, and so many doctors, nurses, and above all, parents of families of their parents, brave parents of their families, and these are the one who made possible to treat these patients of lymphoblastic leukemia, of lymphomas, of Wilms tumor, of retinoblastoma, and so many other malignancies. So things are improving and improving, and inshallah, I'm sure that some of you will be smart enough to join this group of doctors to help these children. So thank you very much for patient listening. And these are other patients of different ages, of different stages of their illness, and who presented with this type of grave manifestation. And when they have with the help of their colleagues, their doctors, their nurses, their paramedical staff, ultimately who made their faces gloomy and enjoying their life. So thank you very much for patient listening, and I'm sure that a day will come after a couple of years that you and your colleague will be joined the squad, and a patient who present with this type of illnesses, you will enlighten their life and to give smile to these patients to come from this phase of their illness to this phase of enjoying their life. Thank you very much for patient listening, and I request you that you go through these MCQs who are in your presentation, answer these MCQs, and last but not the least, also suggest 4 recommendations how to come up in these children, how to have a good outcome of according to you, your recommendation, how we can make the outcome of these children in our beloved country Pakistan their better outcome. So thank you very much for patient listening.